I would like to show you one of the latest colonies I tried to develop.
Okay.
This springtime. I try to do it carefully, otherwise they might be a little bit aggressive.
Okay.
I want to avoid this. So they are not very much aggressive. You can see it here. Okay. So they are quite curious.
And in spring means you set them up completely by
Yes, I try to, let's say, create a new queen, queen bee. And during the past 2 or 3 months, they just breed and breed and breed to get a big, to set up a big colony, which is capable to survive over winter.
Okay.
And during the last 2 weeks, I tried to feed them. They need a weight up to 25 kilograms. I tested just by hand with a
25.5
roundabout, and and with a little bit of experience, you can say, oh, this is quite enough to survive over winter season. Yes, and these are pretty much quiet now, and these are really valuable for the future.
And how many bees do we have now in this hive?
Well,
as a guesstimate.
In literature, people say in summer season around about 50,000, 55,000 individuals. Over winter season, around about 10 or 5,000. This is enough.
Yeah. But one thing I think is you said, you know, over winter, and this seems to be very critical to bring them over winter. We're hearing a lot of beehives are dying over winter.
This is known from the public debates, but honestly, if you are well educated and know how to do that, there's a big chance for them to survive. So the losses I had during the past years was less than 10%. It's much less than the average.
So out of 10 beehives, one dies or might, maybe dies?
Usually with a little bit of experience, you will find the reason. It doesn't have to be a disease.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's just a bad bee queen.
Okay.
So there are diseases known, of course, but not in any case. It's a disease.
So varroa mite would be a disease.
Varroa mite is varroa mite is well known, but it's quite easy to get it under control.
Okay.
I apply
formic acid.
Just acid.
Yeah.
In the summer season and I have an evaporator and it takes 5 or 7 days.
Okay.
200 milliliters of this acid evaporate, and you have to do it in each colony.
Okay.
It doesn't make sense to just to apply it on one colony.
Yeah.
Otherwise the mites might move. So
and the mite move means, you know, one of the infected bees meets another bee or goes.
They meet each other and they just enter another colony.
Yeah. Okay.
Just sometimes by accident, sometimes nobody really knows why they move around.
Okay.
This is known.
Do you see, man? We're here now, really in your beautiful garden, but also surrounded by woods, etc. So do you see, let's say, that there are some environmental facts impacting the disease or the fitness of the bees?
Well, of course, I read journals and articles about this topic. We have quite a lot of agriculture around this place here.
Yeah.
And honestly, I never had the impression that there was some pollution or toxic reaction of the bees.
Yeah.
There are diseases possible and they are known.
Mm-hmm.
We call it foul brood.
Yeah.
And or other bacteria or viruses. They usually don't kill the whole colony.
Yeah, okay.
They don't do.
But let's say also insecticides and, you know, with plant protection, crop protection products, they are always in the debate, insecticides killing bees or, let's say, impacting their fitness, their health states.
Personally, I had never this impression. Mm-hmm. I know it from other beekeepers, colleagues, telling me, but in any case, they were not really sure. There was a never ending in a disaster, so to speak. they just told me, I had the impression there was something, but especially when they moved, for instance, to the rapeseeded fields and others.
But when you look at the responsibilities of yourself taking care about the bees, and it also called beekeeper in a way, or take care of the bees, but also, let's say, industry, is there anything you would say, come on, we should really take up, and this is a shared responsibility, something we really should, let's say, look at?
Well, especially when you have huge areas of monocultures, this is what is known from scientific evaluations. Of course, there has to be a direct dialogue between the beekeeper, the farmers, and the industry. As I said, personally, I don't had any bad experience. I couldn't recognize any change in agility or something.
So it's also about biodiversity, right? Let's say having measures on the field, looking at monoculture, or at least, you know, having really a kind of sustainability concept, and also in let's say having bees, inviting bees, let's say to breed and then drive it forward and pollinate as well. I think it's important as well.
Well, what I think in areas like this where lots of people like me, so keep bees in a private garden. They told me they are not afraid about industrial agriculture and pollution, but toxical products from the neighbor when they treat their plants. So this is maybe something which is supposed to be much more dangerous, because usually private people don't know enough about the dose and the farmers are used to do that. Yeah, private people not.
Absolutely, farmers is a professional business. Why should they, they should spend more than
exactly they need? Exactly. Yeah. They have economical reasons to keep the dose as low as possible.
Just now, tell me, what is this one?
It's probably the most important tool for everybody who tries to keep the bees. Maybe if you try to do that careful, you try to take off this honeycomb. Just try it.
Looking at you, I said it will not work most likely because it's glued.
Yes. It's totally glued. Yeah. It's a mix of wax and everything they find on the trees. And with this simple tool,
you can separate them.
I have to separate them and to move it a little bit before I lift it up carefully. Usually you won't find the queen bee here.
Okay.
They usually like to be in the center.
It smells like honey. It's interesting.
Yeah, and outside it's a mix of honey and feed syrup. I gave them the last 2 weeks
sugar.
Yes, when I started and had only two or three colonies, I melted it in hot water, pure sugar. But when you have 10 or more colonies, you have to buy it. It's quite cheap.
Okay.
It's based on wheat, what I buy, and give them a very
on
good
wheat.
on wheat.
Wheat sugar, okay.
Yeah, and it's. I have quite good experience. I've never had any losses. And usually, such a honeycomb has a weight of around 1 up to 2 kilograms.
Okay.
And they need...
Oh, that makes up your 25 at the
Yes.
end, right?
Yes. Yeah. This is a quite big colony. Mm-hmm. On the opposite, I have younger and... colonies with less bees, and before I decide to bring it into the winter, when you have the experience, you can say this is too weak.
Yeah, okay.
They need a certain amount of bees.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they don't produce enough heat to survive
in the winter.
In the winter.
Okay.
And the sugar is nothing else than the petrol they use.
So sometimes you see some wasps flying into it. What yes. happened with those little colleagues?
There's just steal they the steal. Sweets. They okay. steal it, and up to a certain amount of wasp, they are accepted more or okay. less. Yes. Okay. Symbiotic, yeah. in a certain way.
And you told me, but you also told me, let's say that you're also, let's say, breeding bees, right? So
yes.
it's not only that you have bees and of course honey linked to it and hopefully harvested in the yeah. proper amount and quality and taste, but you're also breeding bees.
Yes.
This is something very special. Can everybody do it? Or
yes, it's yeah. quite simple.
Okay.
To, let's say, produce new queens, you just need a colony yeah. without a queen and without any fresh breed.
Okay.
Then you pick off some eggs mm. or a very, very young larva and bring it into this colony and the bees just decide which one is worth to create or to make a bee queen out okay. of it. And they use another syrup. They produce it
yeah.
and they can really switch between a standard worker bee
yeah.
or the bee queen. It takes 5 days and then there is another honeycomb mm-hmm. and it looks different. And yeah, after 2 weeks we have a new queen.
But on,
it's very simple.
Do you know on which basis they decide?
I think this is still a myth in, okay. in science.
Okay.
People say it's a matter of smell quality. They can check the genes. So, as I said, it's maybe a myth.
Okay.
It's still not really understood the mechanism behind.
Yeah.
But they really decide this egg won't be a queen, the other one will be.
Okay.
So enough to do for the researchers okay. in future.
As you're also a researcher, I think you're at the University of Mannheim.
Yes.
Studying tribology.
So tribology,
maybe
oh yes.
Maybe we need to have a word on this one. Only our friend well, Mr. Google would find it.
Oh yes, you can ask Mr. Google, or may you ask me. Tribology, it could be explained in two different ways. Let me start with the most simple one. It's probably the most or the oldest baby on Earth, let's yeah. say, yes. Yeah. Every time I use that tool, I have a tool, I'm connected with my hand, and each time when you're connected with one body to another and move it, you talk about tribology, meaning friction.
Okay.
As in nature, you can study the tribology between the bee, connected to the wax or the honeycomb. So this is not my profession.
Yeah.
I'm a physicist. I'm working in the mechanical engineering environment, and since 4 years I'm a professor for this topic, tribology, at the University of Applied Science in Mannheim. So the daily topic I'm used to is tribology in machine elements.
Okay.
So that's the and this is quite complicated because it's an interdisciplinary topic connecting physics, chemistry, mechanical engineering, yeah, and even mathematics. Okay. Truth is totally different.
Okay.
It just happened, let's say, by accident. My cousin started with keeping the bees 5-6 years before I started, and he just brought me to his colony, told me, explained, and it was really fascinating. And it took only a few days, and then I had a new hobby, and I really enjoy it because it's totally different from what I'm usually doing day by day, mm-hmm. and it can help you to calm down. You forget, and it's really quiet. Usually, when I open them, and all the bees are around me, yeah. it's pretty loud, and I can't hear anybody calling me. So it's perfect.
No
so I am lost in the bees, in so the to bees. Speak, and this is very nice. I did it for myself.
Yeah. But you also think, as you are, let's say, with a typical professor is, and you don't have only beekeeping. I think you also have now exams also to help other beekeepers.
Exactly.
In terms of, you know, making their bees hives more productive or more healthy.
And this is really a very important point. You can't do that without any education in that topic. Okay. You need to learn
theory. It's better not something for me. Yeah.
Okay. I'm always argue against other beekeepers in a friendly way, but telling them just read a book. Mm-hmm. One book is enough. Just educate yourself. There are lots of possibilities, not only in the internet, but there are many, many possibilities. And I would bet this, what people always call the bee's death, would not as appear in that way as it does in reality. Because I'm really convinced that most of the bees, the losses in the winter season, are, I can say that, are due to bad educated beekeepers.
Okay.
If you don't have the look inside, you have to check, is there any disease? Is there enough food inside? Mm. Is there a healthy queen inside? Then you need experience of other beekeepers, and you have to take a course, a class, a test. And that's what I did very early. And that's it. It's not that difficult. It's not rocket science.
But let's say you said something, you know, how do you see if a bee is healthy or not? Or let's say a queen is healthy or not?
The way how they produce eggs, the nest inside, the size, and the I have an example.
Okay.
May I show you?
Absolutely.
It's an old honeycomb.
Should I come with you or?
Yes, please. Or I can come. I just come back, maybe. Let's compare. This is no breed. This is an empty. These are empty honeycombs. When you open it, when you open a colony and you see such honeycombs, you say, perfect. These are new, these are fresh, they are clean. Yeah. And there are lots.
This doesn't matter.
This is nature. Yeah. Okay. Nothing is perfect in nature, but it's very flat and yes, very homogeneous. This is a wasp. But as long as the honeycomb is homogeneous and clean, you can really, be convinced that this is a healthy colony. This is an example I still kept to show when there is something wrong. Usually, you can see such thick cells here in this honeycomb, and they didn't breed till the end. And there is
heterogeneity in there, right?
There is still a larva. This one is already died. Yeah. But and there is always a mix between food and dirty honeycombs, and that one should be exchanged anyway. Yeah. And you can imagine on such a honeycomb there, it's a mass of bacteria and viruses in it. And don't give the bees such honeycombs for the winter.
Okay.
Not too much of them, at least.
So what do you do if you have not enough honeycombs? You.
I have to combine to.
Okay, then you to.
You can combine a colony, of course. Okay. Doesn't sound very very nice, but you have to kill one of the queens then.
Okay.
But you can make. One out of two colonies.
Yeah.
It's possible, and it's better to have one healthy and strong colony than two weak. And this is not the main reason, but this is one reason why people lose their colonies over winter season.
Okay.
And it's not that difficult.
There's always this saying, you know, people are buying queens on the internet.
Yes.
Is this something, you know, recommendable to, let's say, get new genetics in or something? This is important.
It's not only to recommend, but it's by law forbidden to buy queens without a certificate. Okay. You need certified bee queens.
Yeah.
This is okay, I guess, in Europe, but it doesn't make sense, I think, to import queens from outside the European Union, which is sometimes happening. I didn't do that, but it doesn't make sense. It's easy to produce their own.
So let's say if you produce your own queens and you sell them to friends or give them to
certificate. I did, yes. You have to take pieces out of this honeycomb to send it to an institution. They will check it, especially this foul brood bacteria disease has to be checked, and therefore you need this certificate. Yeah. For other diseases, it's not necessary. It's usually not tested.
Yeah. So where are we now?
So this is the showroom. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is a marketplace, so to speak, where I just sell my hobby. No, I'm honest. I'm selfish. I just did it for myself to relax.
And
yeah. My famous
tribology
tool. Let's just get rid of it. It's really the best glue they produce. And now I open it to have a deeper look inside. We have just to wait a couple of seconds that they find back. And I'm sure the queen is on the other side.
Of course.
It's always the other side. So I have to try to get it off here.
So again, here you see, you know, as you said, feet is outside, right?
Yes. Inside you have open and closed honeycombs. And here you can see the bee queen here.
Pink lady.
The pink, yes. The colors define the year. Each year is defined, and we have five colors from bright to dark.
Yeah.
White, yellow, red, green, blue. This year is blue, meaning this bee queen is about 2 years old.
Okay.
Yes, you have, when they appear, you have to find it, and you have to pick it off. And yes, a drop of super glue.
Yeah.
And I have lots of these plates.
And the super glue doesn't, let's say, hurt her or?
No, use the jelly one.
Okay.
If you use the liquid one, might happen that it's gluing the whole bee and they would die. No.
Yeah.
Well, it's at least 2 years old, so she's in a good shape.
Is she laying an egg or is this?
Sometimes she's, yeah. Yeah, they can see it, maybe. There is an egg at the end. And sometimes when they get nervous, they just lose one.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that quite often. And yes, the nest inside. You have closed honeycombs and opened.
Mm-hmm.
The closed, I should know that. It's about 14 or 16 days it's closed, and then a new worker comes out.
These friends over there?
Which one? Oh, yeah. In case of emergency, they try to pick up as much honey as possible.
Yeah.
Because if it's necessary to escape, they have the petrol.
Okay, so they can...
To fly away. And this is a typical reaction. Maybe you have seen beekeepers smoking, smokers.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is a signal for fire. So they just try to pick as much honey as possible to be aware, to disappear or to escape. And during that time, they don't have the time to pick you.
Ah.
That's
a trick.
I don't use that. Mm. I used that in the beginning, but I no longer apply smoke because it's a lot of stress for the bees.
We learned on your let's say your cultivation beehives that you need 25k to let's say get it survived.
Roundabout,
But this is whatever.
This one could never survive over winter.
Yeah.
Maybe in September or lately in October, I have to take off the bee queen and put it in a weak colony, yeah, which I usually would not try to survive or to bring through the winter.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you now see, maybe at the end of our interview, is saying, you see that, you know, bees are really necessary for agriculture. They pollinate.
Absolutely.
It's important for productivity.
Definitely.
There is the bee loss. So when you have your vision as a beekeeper,
what would be your dream
for Christmas?
Oh yes, let's
healthy
yes,
I know, but
only healthy bees. Honestly, I would really be happy if the discussion will be open.
Yeah.
Meaning, what my experience on both sides, farmers, politics, society, and beekeepers, we have only black and white.
Okay.
Always black and white. And these are the good guys, these are the bad guys. And as a beekeeper, you're always the good guy. Mm. As a beekeeper, yeah, I can say, no, this is nonsense.
Yeah.
My vision would be, let's start a really open discussion. Mm-hmm. Let's get rid of all these myths and legends. Let's learn together.
Yeah.
Of course, in case scientists find out there is a toxic stuff inside of the plant treatment, let's get rid of it. That's important, but I'm pretty convinced and looking positive into the future. When we have an open discussion, then we will end up with a community between society, industry, and beekeepers.
Yeah,
it's possible. It's people might say this sounds a little bit naive. Yes, I say yes, but let's start.
Yeah, I think we have to start. And I think, as you said, it's about a balanced approach. There is no black and white, and depending where you are, it's different. But the most open part is really, and we are open to this as well, starting the dialogue.
Yeah.
Open, also with a fair way of criticism. Of
exactly.
But constructive and on a science basis.
Yes.
Super.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. It was a great pleasure. We are here, as you know, somewhere in
thank you very much.
Beautiful garden. Jürgen, thanks for making time available.
It was a pleasure.
And tasting your honey later on. Thank you.
Definitely.
Bye.
BASF. We create chemistry.